listening to the short stories that bring a lot of sermons in our lives. As we continue, let us once again bow our heads in prayer. Loving Lord, merciful Father in heaven, once again we come before thy throne of grace to praise your name. We come before you bringing our praises and thanksgiving. We seek your face through the Holy Spirit to guide us as we continue our study this afternoon. Thank you, Lord, for granting our request. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amidst the pain and suffering in this world, many people cry out like a popular original Filipino music which asks if the Lord is asleep. This afternoon, we find comfort in the assurance that the God we serve never sleeps. He sees our pains and sorrows, our challenges, and he celebrates with us. For the past days, we have learned through short stories, wonderful sermons on how to live and how to pattern our lives. This afternoon and tomorrow, we will not study on how to live, but no more about God, the Lord God we serve. Our text is found in Luke chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." The triple parables that we will study this afternoon until tomorrow is a response of Jesus Christ to the mutterings, the murmurings of the scribes and Pharisees. This afternoon we will study two stories. And tomorrow we'll study the other one. But in these parables, the lost coin and the lost sheep, we see the prejudice of the rabbis and teachers of the law to the attitude of Jesus Christ, how he mingles with sinners. The rabbis had been disappointed with Jesus. They asked, "Why is this man who claimed to have a lofty character associate with sinners?" They say, "He should know better. These people are sinners. These people are moral outcasts. These people are not worthy of company. He should show contempt and indifference and an acceptance and compassion to the sinners." Simply saying, they murmured against Jesus Christ because they did not approve of Jesus' method of dealing with people. The Pharisees and teachers of the law are considered educated. They are refined and religiously superior. But the thing is, they look at themselves as guardians of society. And for me, it's not bad. But the thing is, they look at themselves better than others. They thought that others are dirty. Others are unworthy. And this is what is not acceptable in the eyes of the Lord Jesus Christ. But then again, it brings us a question. But why is it that when they are with Jesus, they are only, or they only felt condemnation? And while the sinners are drawn to Christ, it's a contrast. Those who thought they are righteous and clean and superior are condemned by Jesus Christ. But those whom the Pharisees and Sadducees and scribes and teachers of the law consider to be unworthy are welcomed by Jesus Christ. It's a paradox. They say, this man receiveth sinners. And to them it is unacceptable. But let's take notice. This is what made the difference. The sinners in the presence of the Pharisees only felt scorn and condemnation. On the other hand, they felt in the presence of Jesus an escape from the pit of sin. I know we have experienced guilt. And when we experience guilt, it is difficult for us to describe how wretched we are. We feel hopeless. We feel dirty and abandoned. But what if, in spite of that feelings, someone comes to you and step on you further down? What would you feel? I believe that the Pharisees understood that the publicans and the sinners felt so bad about themselves. Because if you look into the parable of the Pharisee and the publican, these quote-unquote sinners could not even consider themselves looking up and pleading for mercy, but they are bowing their heads, beating their breast. They know the religious status. They know that they are unworthy. Now, in a very practical sense, whom do you like to be with? Do you like to be with people who always put you down and belittle you or ignore you or trample your ego? Or would you be like with people who, even though you feel hopeless and so little, give you some self-worth? Whom do you want to be with? In this case, why were the sinners, quote-unquote, drawn to Jesus? Because it is only with Jesus they found meaning in life. It is only with Jesus that they find the reason to exist. Sinners do feel the wretchedness. And I believe only a few sinners, or those who are really unmindful of their own bad ways, feel so arrogant about sinning. But I believe many who think who are sinful are so low that we need to bring them up to Jesus Christ. And so in response to the murmurings of these quote-unquote righteous people, Jesus Christ told these three parables. These three stories have one essential lesson. It talks about the love of God in giving us worth in spite of our unworthiness. In spite of people telling us that we are unworthy. In spite of people telling us that we belong to the scrap heap. In spite of Satan telling us that we are unworthy because we are dirty. Christ said, I rebuke you, Satan. I have clothed him with my robe of righteousness. Tax collectors are classified as social outcasts. Together the prostitutes, together with the Gentiles, together with the Samaritans. Because these tax collectors, in the concept of Jewish people, especially Jewish leaders, they are offensive in the sense that they were employed by the Romans to collect taxes from the Jewish people. Remember, during this time, Israel or Judah was under the rulership of the Romans. And to a Jew, a fellow Jew, extracting or collecting tithe for the Roman government is a treason and a betrayal of trust of his fellow man as a Jew. They were considered traitors by the Jews, and they have alienated themselves from society. That is why, in the experience of Zacchaeus, he was derided by many people. They were classed with the moral outcasts, these tax collectors. They were classified with the Samaritans. And that is why in John chapter 4, verse 9, the woman or the Samaritan woman, when Jesus Christ confronted and opened a conversation with her, said, "We have no dealings." Or I mean, the Jews have no dealings with us. We have already studied the background of this animosity. But Jesus dared to take a risk to bring down social prejudices, social barriers, to show that love, the love that knows no limit. Barriers between the Jews and the sinners had been erected. But yes, they could not prevent Jesus from teaching the outcast the message of salvation. And he bridged that gap even before Calvary's cross. He wanted to bring the lost ones to God. The highlight of these triple parables could be stated in three words. Number one, being lost. As I read the Christ object lesson and the hidden treasures, I found an insight. Jesus seldom called people sinners. He calls them lost. Lost. And so one point in the parables, so these three parables, is the lostness of humankind. Sometimes they are lost like the what? The sheep. Not from viciousness or deliberate choice, but because of weak will and headlessness. Sometimes the sheep wanders, not minding that the rest of the flock is far away. And by this wandering, one lamb or one sheep will get lost. Sometimes they are lost like the coin, not from their own guilt, but from another's fault or mischances of life. This passage brought me to a self-argument. Can I attribute sin to others because of my wrong doings or because of being, if others cause me to fall, can I consider others at fault? Until finally I found a text in the scriptures when Jesus said, "Who unto you, who causes your brother to fall? It is better for you to what? To be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around your neck." It brought me further questions. And I came to realize that if I was the one who was caused to fall, I cannot excuse my sin. But culpability is also attributed to the one who caused a falling of a brother. So, for example, I fall. I cannot make this an excuse and exempt myself from sin. But the Bible tells us that others who cause others to sin are likewise culpable or can be considered guilty in this sense. In the parable of the lost coin, it is an example of how others are lost because of others' negligence. And sometimes, Others are lost like the prodigal son through self-will and own calculated risks. They deliberately walk away. Therefore, they are lost. But then again, all these three parables tell of pity more than condemnation. It reveals God's longing to bring the sinners or the lost ones back home. And that is why we find the concept of a God who never sleeps in the triple parables of Luke chapter 15. And in contrast, the Pharisees who never classify themselves as lost and they are quick to call them other men sinners are in fact the ones who are really lost. Lost in their own self-righteousness. The publican and the Pharisee. We said it yesterday that the Bible declares that the one who considered himself as a sinner was the one who was justified rather than one who considers himself as the righteous one. The barren self-righteousness seen in the people who claims themselves righteous will bring out the real picture of hopelessness. The real ones who are lost rather than the ones they call and consider sinners. In the parable of the lost son, we see the elder brother murmuring that his prodigal brother has come home. Maybe when he left, he could have said, "Good riddance." But when he came back, the prodigal son came back, he murmured. He was murmuring. The Jewish leaders murmured about Jesus going to the house of Zacchaeus. Another point in these parables is about the Lord seeking for the lost. First is the lostness. Second is the seeking. Jesus' first parable in Luke chapter 15 talks about a lost sheep. But that is not the primary point. The primary sermon in that story is not the lost sheep. It is the seeker of the lost sheep. The prime character is our God who never sleeps. Until one lost soul is found and restored into the fold. Here in the parable, Jesus said, "Who among you, suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them, does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it?" The shepherd did not say, "Well, I have 99. I have had enough of labor throughout the day. I can wait until tomorrow to find that lost one." No. He never slept. The Bible tells us, until he found. It talks about the shepherd who goes after the lost one and who rejoices when he finds it. Praise the Lord, our God is a seeking God in spite of our lostness. We are not hopeless. This is not the kind of God the Jew in the audience would have recognized. Many of the hearers of Jesus during the time believed that Christ will accept sinners. But not in the picture of the good shepherd seeking the sheep. Yeah, they accept that a sinner coming back to him on what? Bended knees.
The concept of God who takes risk to seek the sinners was beyond imagination. Yeah. If you come back on bended knees and fall before the patriarch, you're accepted. But Jesus told a story that was so radical from the perspective of his hearers, but the real picture of our God. In 1511, Martin Luther, on bended knees, ascended the Scala Sancta, or the Holy Stairway, reciting the Lord's Prayer. He was crawling on bended knees, and when he reached the top, he said, far upraising, "I don't know if it's the real thing to attain righteousness." The Scala Sancta is a 28 marble step in a building near a basilica in Rome, wherein religious leaders give indulgences in exchange for every step. And many believed until now that you will receive restitution, forgiveness, and even good favor from on high if you scale the steps on bended knees. And so Luther did that in 1511. Tradition says that this stairway was originally ascended by Jesus Christ towards the courtroom of Pilate. And in 326, St. Helenas, the mother of Constantine, brought that staircase from Jerusalem to Rome. And that is why many pilgrims still seek repentance and righteousness and favor through ascending that staircase. But we believe repentance could not be earned that way, and forgiveness. It was taught in Jesus' time that before God's love is extended to the sinners, he must first repent. In their view, repentance is a work by which men earn the favor of heaven. Hidden Treasures 127. That was their concept. And it is no wonder that this concept is still prevalent today. Coming from the Jewish tradition of Jesus' time. In the parable of the lost sheep, Christ teaches that salvation does not come through our seeking after God, but through God's seeking after us. Because on our way, in our own self, we are lost in the labyrinth of sin, and there is no way for us to find a way out until God's grace and mercy comes running for us. Another point I could not miss in the Christ Object Lesson, page 189. We do not repent in order that God may love us, but he reveals to us his love in order that we might repent. What compels us to come to repentance? It is not our own nature. Only when we realize and discover and understand the pleadings of God through his love through Jesus Christ, our Lord, are we compelled to come to repentance. And then, I know we like the song, if I'm not mistaken, forgive me if I will not give the correct singers, but I think this song was sung by the Heritage Singers when they sung, "Mercy Came A-Running." Yeah. Mercy came a-running. I would like to share with you one more time the messages or the message of our theme song. The last two stanzas. Now, I love this song. This is a picture of my own spiritual journey. I could relate to the struggles of Charles Wesley.
He wrote, "Long my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I walk, the dungeon flamed with light. My chains, what? Fell off. My heart was free. I rose, went forth, and followed thee." If we are bound in the bondage of sin, finding the grace of Jesus Christ and His love seeking for us will help us shake off our chains, and our hearts will be freed from the burdens of sin. And follows, "No condemnation now I dread. Jesus and all in Him is mine. Alive in Him, my living head, and clothed in righteousness divine. We can approach the eternal throne, and we can claim the crown through Christ as our own." What a message. The second parable talks about the lost coin. It is not difficult to imagine losing a coin in a first century Palestinian peasant's house. For those of you who have been to Jerusalem, maybe you had a tour in some places that talks about a traditional Palestinian house. It has only a small 18-inch window for lighting. And in that setting, that coin was lost. And not only that, in a Palestinian home, the dirt floor covered with layers and layers of straw and other things mixed up on the floor will make it difficult for you to find something that was lost. There were a lot of other things that had gotten mixed up, including many other bits and pieces. And so this woman lost her coin. And she was having difficulty finding. I remember in our old home in the barrio, it is a two-story home with a bamboo floor, maybe bamboo strips, maybe about 3 feet above the ground. And you can just imagine dirt piling under the dirt, under the bamboo strips floor. And then we children would find it a wonderful time looking for fallen coins there and rubber bands. But it was not easy. Here in this setting, we see the picture of the woman on her knees, holding on to an oil lamp and then with one hand sifting through the mess, looking for the coin. And we see God coming into this world, getting down on His knees in the rubble of this sin-gutted world, looking for the lost ones. If we read and reread the stories in Christ's Object Lessons or the Hidden Treasures, every time we read it, we find wonderful insights that will help us understand better the love of God for us. Above anything, this parable tells that salvation never starts from myself. I've mentioned some other time that while other world religions is a continual search about God, Christianity, much more, Seventh-day Adventism believes in a God who makes the first move to find us in our lostness. And the final point in the parables is rejoicing. After being lost, after the seeking, there comes rejoicing. In the first parable alone, the words joy and rejoicing are used 3 times in 3 verses. Verse 5, 6, and 7 talks about the joy being expressed by the finder of the lost sheep. There is rejoicing, and he calls others to rejoice with him. There is rejoicing in the presence of the angels and the whole heavens when one lost finds his way home. Jesus says that there is joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. And not only God, but the whole heavens rejoices. The message of the parable is familiar to all of us about this testimony of God's love. There is another point in the parable that goes against the thinking of the scribes and Pharisees during Jesus' time. They believe that there is joy in heaven over one sinner who is obliterated before God. That's their concept. If a tragedy will strike, it is considered as a judgment, and they rejoice over people who are lost. When in fact, we find in Luke chapter 9, verses 54 and 55, that when the disciples, when Christ and his disciples were not welcomed in a village in Samaria, the disciples asked the Lord, "Is it better for us to seek heaven that these Samaritans will be consumed by fire?" Yeah. They find joy in the destruction of others. They find joy in the destruction of whom they call sinners or lost. But Christ says he finds joy when one lost sinner comes back to God. "Not so," said Jesus, as he pictures the God who risks himself in searching for the lost and throwing out a party when they are found. What a contradiction with the human tendency and reaction to the lost and the sinners. Don't you think it is time for us to change our picture about God? In the scriptures, we find God's wrath. But the object of his wrath is not sin, but sinners. There are others who deny that God is angry. That's another way. Extreme. We do find in the scriptures the picture of an angry God. The wrath of God is present in the scriptures. But the object of God's wrath is sin, not sinners. But then again, at the end, after his call and seeking for mercy is unheeded, of course, judgment will come. However, the Lord is still seeking and calling the lost to come home. Would we join Christ in his mission so long as there is yet time? The call is still open. Let us seek and save that which was lost. The song, familiar song, says, "Amazing grace, I was once lost, but now I'm found." I believe in one way or another, we have experienced being lost. Not literally, but I believe we have been lost in our spiritual journey. And if Christ show compassion to us in our lostness, is it that difficult to show the same compassion to others who are struggling to find their way home? May God help us this afternoon realize the point that God never sleeps until one lost sinner finds his way back home. And this afternoon, let me add by saying, God is calling us to become instruments of helping him seeking the lost. For we were once lost, but now we are found. So it's time for us to join. Join Christ in his mission to seek and save that which was lost. And let us join our Lord God in seeking
the people who are lost in sin. Let us join God, the God who never sleeps, the God who seeks, and the God who rejoices. And finally, we look forward for the day when all of us will be rejoicing in that heavenly home, the place for the redeemed. Thank you, Lord. May the Lord bless us and grant us joy as we help and share with Him the blessings of finding the lost. Good afternoon to everyone.